Charles, welcome back to season 2, episode 2. Today, Charles is on the pitch. Swing and a miss.
Hello. Swing and a miss.
Today, we're going to play Would You Rather with Charles.
We'll start the show off real quick. By the way, congratulations, Michigan. Congratulations on the fan base. It was absolutely everything I thought it was going to be listening to the Paul Feinbaum show. That was fantastic.
You got to listen to Paul. Was it all that I could imagine and more?
It was. You had Michigan fans coming in.
Did he give him any credit?
Oh, actually, yeah. Listen, just straight up, Paul's tone.
T.A. Crow
has switched. Paul's tone has switched. He said being there live, watching it, blah, blah, blah. That team's special. He goes, they win it. Like, that's them. And that gives me a hell of a lot of comfort, too, moving forward, which not that I needed it at all. I've watched this team all season. They have just been bigger than those. Penn State was different, but it was just gorgeous. It was beautiful.
No team.
Yeah, the callers coming in, they were yelling at Nick. They were yelling at Nick, throwing one dude under the bus.
Oh, dude,
everyone was screaming that, why didn't they call a play that was in the end zone?
It wouldn't matter. They act like they were playing to win that game. They're trying to tie, for fuck's sake.
Yeah. Oh, it was so frustrating. It was like listening to them leading up to the show, the game. They were going to win 50-3, 65-7.
Well, that was the whole 35. That was the sports skeeta, the 35 point. They're going to win by 35. Bama was going to win by 35. Here's the thing that I got to watch a lot of, like Joe Klatt was there with his family. A lot of NFL and NCAA football personalities were there. And they all said the same thing, that it was special to watch that team. Nobody's ever going to do again what Michigan had to do with no coaches, with playing three different coaches coached for him this year. They had Harbaugh's son was like the assistant coach one game.
His dad was there.
Mike Hart.
Yeah. Mentor.
And then the whole Stallions thing. Like, this team went through so much this year. It's crazy to me. No team's ever gone through that kind of shit.
Team 144 has been a story, man. Team 144 has been a story. But I loved hearing Blake Corum at the end go, we'll see you in Houston.
Yeah.
That was his answer to basically everything. We'll see you in Houston.
Did you happen to catch JJ hanging out after the stands had completely cleared?
Yeah, just soaking it all up.
Yeah. He's gone, man. He's gone next year.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, he's going pro.
He balled out, man. He missed a couple of throws.
At the end, he did, yeah.
You can't expect more. You want to because you've seen other people, but everybody's unique, and the dude's balling out.
I mean, I'm gonna call this right cutties. Now that Edwards and Corum are going to have huge games versus that Washington defense. They give up a lot of yards on the ground. Defense does.
I think they're somewhere around 90th. It's not going to be.
Yeah. And they had over 100 versus Bama's defense, and that was pretty good defense. So
very much so.
Again,
congratulations, Team 144. That was awesome.
Congratulations, Washington, and big Phoenix energy, Charles would say.
Yeah. That's fun. I did. And it's funny you brought up Joe, Mr. Klatt again. And again, I'm going to call him Mr. Klatt because I jumped the gun, and respect needs to be earned. So I guess moving forward for a little while, anyways, I'll just call him Mr. Klatt. But he did bring up something specific, and it was, if you look at this Washington team, and he compared them to the 2021 Ohio State, right? And it's like Michigan has built a team to beat Ohio State. The best matchup we could have asked for in this championship game arguably is this Washington team. Now, again,
an undefeated national champion. This is what college football wanted. They wanted it to be undefeated. Two undefeated teams, the two best teams all season.
They had to earn it. They had to earn it. Texas was a good team. Alabama was a good team. I don't think they should have been there, but still, whatever. I don't think it should have been FSU, but by the numbers, which is something I live and die by. I did all the way up until the moment that the damn college football committee hammered me down into the grave. But FSU by the numbers should have been there. I think Georgia should have been there, though. And it should have been Georgia, Washington. And then I guess in this crazy ass scenario,
Florida State,
Texas.
Oh, it should have been Florida State, Georgia, Michigan.
By the numbers. But by the numbers, I don't disagree with you. By the numbers. I'm just saying by the feel, because you just can't. For the life
people need to get off of this 27, 29 player that they would have even competed against freaking Georgia. Dude, they scored 3 points. And I don't give a shit if it's your freaking, if it's your third string, fourth string players. You come out there and you only put up 3 friggin' points. Come
on.
That's
why I'm saying that's my hindsight final four. That's just what it was. Like,
no. I'm talking about the fans that are sitting there. Whoa, these players. Dude, come on.
I wish they would just drop it.
It's over with.
ACC is much, much different. You know, people are sitting here talking to like, oh, the Big Ten, they failed. And but they're still, I think we're 6-4.
Florida State's got their quarterback now. They got Ngaliye or whatever from Oregon State.
Yeah, yeah. That's Cam Ward went to the NFL.
Yeah,
he's gonna be a second or third rounder. Go and try and get that money, I guess.
I don't even think he'd be a third rounder. I bet you'd be a fifth rounder.
Could be the next Brock Purdy. All right,
next Brock Purdy. So he's gotta go, Mr. Irrelevant. Yeah,
well done, Team 144. Let's jump into this. Would you rather?
Are you ready? We'll do some sports ones, a little twist. Mm-hmm. All right, Charles, these are questions that kind of came up with some of them, and then some of them might. Found. Would you rather be the star of a bad team or an average player on an elite team?
Star of a bad team.
So you just want to be the guy. You want to be him. You want to be him.
No, but I don't like leaving it up to anybody else.
So here's one that's really going to come down to. Put yourself in an NFL player's shoes, and I know exactly what player you're going to think of when I say this. Would you rather win the MVP or your team to win a championship?
Team to win a championship.
In that sense, who am I talking about? Because he's never won one.
Oh, God. I don't know. Now I'm excited.
CMC.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Because I don't think both can happen.
No, no, and I don't think there's an argument anymore either. I think Lamar Jackson, he's got to be the MVP
after that last game. But it's crazy. You can't throw them
two games. And it's a fluid league. Opinions change week to week. Players change week to week. And Lamar Jackson isn't unanimous MVP. I think it's rigged.
And here's one that would have came down to it had Alabama actually made that touchdown run with Milrow. Would you rather ensure overtime or risk losing it to win in regulation? Going for two.
It's a very good question. And my answer is I would go for two. And the reason for this is because I think that it shows ultimate trust in who you've taught all year, who you've groomed all year, all season, who you've told all these things to all season, right? It's not about trusting your defense in that moment or not trusting your defense in that moment. To me, it's about trusting your team to take it to the finish line.
Yeah. That's and what would, we get when we see teams go for it on fourth and one all the time, too. Absolutely. The tush push and whatnot. Now, here's a good one. Now, this makes me think of a college coach right off the top of my head. Would you rather retire as a forgotten coach with a winning record or a famous coach that's always been known to lose championships?
Where am I making money, to be honest with you?
But I mean,
am I Jimbo Fisher? Because if I'm Jimbo Fisher, I'm not mad. If I'm
this reminds me of Dick Franklin in freaking what's his face out there in USC that we rip on. Yeah, Lincoln Riley.
Lincoln Riley. Yeah. And again, if I'm either one of those two, I'm not mad either. I've made bank. I've set myself up with Edward Jones, I think, or who knows, maybe Fidelity. I don't know.
Wherever you're getting paid, right?
Yeah. Who knows? I've set myself up somewhere real nice. Charles Schwab.
This is a good one right here with the whole Harbaugh scenario swirling around with him hiring an agent and everything. Would you rather coach a college or a professional football team?
Oof. Already done both or not having done any at all?
I'm thinking it's just straight off the bat. What trips your trigger? What would make you feel better about your career? If you were to succeed at either level, what would it be? Because we already know what Harbaugh's is, and it's the kids. So that's why he chooses Michigan.
Yeah, although age could play a factor into this. It's probably easier to be a head coach in the NFL than it is to be a head coach in college.
Depends on what conference you're in, probably.
I got to say college. I would say college. The moments you get in college outweigh the moments you get in the NFL. In the NFL, it's more personal than it is in college. In college, it's more of a unified glory moment. You see a lot of happiness with the Super Bowl and stuff like that. But hell, the moments you get in the locker room, the scholarship moments, yada, yada, yada. It's got to be college. For me, it's got to be college.
Now, this is one that might be a little difficult for you to say. You might get it. You might go right off the bat with this one, or you're going to think about this one a lot. Would you rather stay on a below average team or join your rival to win a title?
Oh, I would stay on a below average team, man. No way, dude. I can't. The rival, no. Hell no. I'd rather make the rival earn it than join them and I would just be so mad at myself the rest of my life. I'd be so angry.
Here's one. This is a good one too.
Yeah.
Would you rather pass for the winning touchdown or run it in on a long touchdown run for the score? Because if you throw it, you get both of them. You get the good pass and you get the freaking touchdown for throwing it. If you run it in,
Trenches if you run it in. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I guess I'm going to have to say the running back, to be honest with you, because the only reason I'm not saying the quarterback is because it's the earned in the trenches. That's what was weighing in my mind, right? Where the scale was. And the only thing that stopped me from saying, oh, dude, throwing it in all day. And I thought about the movie, The Replacements. And I was just like, yeah, man, that'd be so cool. And then all of a sudden it was like, but the running back, you earn that in the trenches, man.
Yeah. I mean, fucking get her.
Oh, dude, that's like war, bro.
Yeah.
That's like
tough.
That's my bread and butter, man. Outside of my wife and my family, there isn't much more I think about more than war. So
Here's another one. Here's another tough one. For me, this one would be a lot tougher if I had to answer it. Would you rather be a legendary coach or a legendary player?
Coach?
Because I feel that way too, because your career could be, you impact more. I'm just saying you impact more players.
The amount of impact you could create through a tree of life type scenario from coaching. Oh, man. Yeah. I've signed up for that American football coach. I've paid the money for it a few times just because every once in a while at the beginning of a year, I'll read the email and I'm like, yeah, this could be the year I become an NFL coach. I'll go take the test, and or this could be the year I become a high school coach. Yeah, dude, coaching all day.
Would you rather play a game in the rain or the snow?
Coaching or playing?
Just playing.
Oh, man. Snow. Definitely the snow.
Yeah. Would you rather have a trophy or an award named after you?
But do you get a trophy with the award?
No, it's just one or the other. Oh, the award would be like a plaque. The trophy would be like the Lombardi.
If you're talking about the sense of a Lombardi, then yeah, I'm taking the trophy all day, because awards can be changed all the time or taken away because somebody on the internet didn't like what somebody else said.
All right. Here's one that's been in the headlines lately a lot, and I think you know where this one's coming from. Would you rather tank an entire season to get the top overall draft pick or just miss the playoffs and get a mid-round draft pick? We both stand on this, but if it's you, you're the coach.
Oh, I'm the coach in this scenario?
Yeah.
If I'm the coach, I want the playoffs. Because if I'm tanking, I'm sick of hearing about
or just miss the playoffs and get a mid-round pick.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I'd rather just miss the playoffs. Absolutely. All right. Because the team is improving, and I can do wonderful things with a mid-round draft pick.
Would you rather be tall and slow or short and fast? None of these is very positive. That's all I can say.
Man, yeah, that sucks. I'm trying to think of all the things I could do being short and fast. Could I play cricket?
Yeah.
Could I play field hockey?
Yeah.
I could not play. What's that shit where they fucking throw on horses? They hit the ball with the mallet. What is that?
Oh, yeah.
Is that field hockey?
No.
I guess we both know at this point, I have no idea what the hell field hockey is. I'm tall and slow.
Yeah.
For one reason. I don't want to spend my whole life asking people to get shit off the top shelf.
This is nice. This is a tricky one. Would you rather play but always lose, or win but always sit the bench?
Hey, but always lose. Obviously, I'm not the reason we're losing. Obviously, I'm not the reason we're losing. Because all I know is that you learn from your losses, right? This ain't like the Pistons, who obviously didn't learn nothing. They won one and then got smacked. Like, why'd you even win? You could have cemented that crap. Now you're giving that honor to somebody else later on down the road. Anyways.
This is a kiss in your sister one, because it could be the same thing. Would you rather always lose the championship game or never make the playoffs?
Oh,
that's the Buffalo Bills mentality.
So are we talking Jim Kelly's career?
Yeah, or, Jim Kelly's career.
Or what's his name there and that the Angels? Mike Trout's career. Which one would you rather? Mike Trout's career or Jim Kelly? Part of the greatest team ever, the United States Army. I don't know what it's like to lose. This is really hard to answer. I guess the Jim Kelly experience. I'd rather the Kelly experience. Is it Jim?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd rather the Kelly experience.
Here's the last one. And this one, I guess this is one that I found doesn't really make that much sense to me, but I thought it was interesting because either way, one of them shows grit. And the other one is just, it could be the atmosphere. Would you rather go undefeated on the road or at home? You got to think about this, because
at home,
one of them means that you've got grit and you're a good team if you're on the road winning all the time. If you're at home, it could just be the atmosphere.
Yeah, no, I'd rather win at home.
But a lot of teams go undefeated at home.
Yeah, it's the fans thing for me.
What team do you think would have a better record, though, the team that won every game on the road or the team that won every game at home?
It depends on, they're both, it'd be 500 regardless.
No, I think if you look up history, teams that went undefeated on the road probably only had one loss on the, at home. Because going undefeated on the road is incredibly difficult to do. I don't even know. I don't even know outside of a few teams have ever even done it.
In a short sample, Green Bay Packers 2010 when they won the Super Bowl.
Did they win every game on the road? Yeah.
They went to Philadelphia and beat the Eagles. That was the year.
They lost three at home that year?
David Akers missed like four kicks at 40 yards.
Did you see Mason Crosby miss the kick the other night?
I felt so bad for him.
I was like, you got to be shitting me, man.
But the other thing, too, now that I've been focused more on a big picture than a fan-induced coma picture.
Man,
the Green Bay front office has made some really good decisions.
Oh, yeah.
If we don't focus so much on like the Barry Sanders or the TJ Watt or the maybe that's our karma for just great quarterbacks and great wide receivers and great offensive line. And
I'm interested to see what they can find this year in the draft with three picks in the top 60.
That's what I'm saying. It'll be fun. But yeah, dude, hell yeah.
They figured that offensive line out, man. They have figured that shit out. So I'm happy about that. Absolutely.
And we're with David on the bench.
I don't know. He might want to come back and play after seeing this team freaking ball out.
I really hope so. Arguably, the only thing we really know is he can't fucking stand artificial turf.
Yeah, and he don't. Why would you want to go play on a field where he's not going to play, what, eight games for a whole season? So,
yeah.
Whatever. Real. This is what it is.
I thought that was fun. Dude, I liked it. I had a really good time. Okay, so we'll wrap this up here quickly with a quick top 10 and then a small deep dive into two of the things, and only because one of those things is effing amazing.
It's not tacos, is it? It's not tacos again?
No. Top 10 candy consumption in America, right?
Oh, boy. Is it candy brands or just candy?
Yeah, it's some candy brands.
All right.
The average American consumes 8 pounds of candy per year.
Good lord, eight fucking pounds of candy per year, dude.
Check this out. So number one, Snickers. Two, peanut butter cups. Three, Hershey's Kisses. Four, Kit Kat. Five, M&M's. Six, Hershey Bar. Seven, Twix. Eight, Starburst. Nine, Skittles. 10, Hershey's Cookies and Cream.
Could you imagine if you're the person that ate 8 pounds or 9 pounds of Starburst? What would that look like? Oh, that would be like
so
fucking garbage bag full of fucking Starburst, man.
Let's dive into this. Yeah, dude, it'd be fucking nuts. I could have been one of those people for a little while. Yeah. I love
pink. What was your flavor?
I love
all of them. Were you the guy too?
The one I liked the least was the red one. No, man.
Really? The red one? What was that? Like strawberry or some shit? I can't remember.
Did you ever do the thing
that I was motioning with my fucking fingers? Like you take two and you make one flavor and you just squish them together.
Dude, I get crazy with it. Yeah. I would twist them like you made Tootsie Rolls. Like five or six. At one point, I might do the whole pack and I would just twist the whole fucking thing into this and it would just. Yeah, dude.
A big candy rope.
Willy Wonka ain't got shit on this.
Willy Wonka ain't got shit on Charles. He's got that thing on lockdown.
I put some dentist kids through college. I probably have. So one of the cool things about the Reese's peanut butter cup, right? The Hershey's Reese's peanut butter cup is like a quick backstory on it is the guy, H.B. Reese, actually worked for Hershey's.
Yeah.
1920 something, but got pissed off or something didn't happen. It's a really cool story. You're gonna have to go look it up. But anyways, he left, created the Hershey's peanut butter cup. But what was really cool, the only reason is the official product named in the beginning was Penny Cups. And that was because you could purchase them for 1 cent. That's almost the only thing I didn't know about Reese's Peanut Butter Cups.
That's crazy.
Their original name was Penny Cups. And I thought that was pretty fucking cool.
Man, shit's really come a long way since then, hasn't it? It's 225 now for 1 cent.
Yeah, fucking inflation. Taxes. We pay more taxes now than what happened when original America was like, fuck your tea, Britain. So one of my favorite candies, right? And I have Skittles stories out the ass because Skittles is like my favorite candy. I fucking love Skittles.
Yeah, me too. I can buy like those big family bags and just eat them at work.
I squish the fuck out of them at times. I'll squish 3, 4, 5 of them together. I'll be like, a little Skittles sandwich might I have?
Yeah.
But I never looked up any Skittles history, and this is where shit got weird. Skittles, the chewy candy that we're so familiar with today, first came into existence 1974. It's not that long ago.
No, right? But I think I know where you're going with this.
Although the creator of Skittles is unknown, it is widely accepted that an unknown British company was the original manufacturer. What?
They don't even know. They're just like, Candyman.
Do we not know who created Skittles? This is 1974. We've had 2 world wars.
So here's the thing. How come we can't claim that there's no patents? Like, we can't claim that we started the company. I wasn't even born yet, but I can still say that we started. I start in the womb, man, swimming around in the ball sack. I freaking had this idea of Skittles.
So I understand not knowing where the name Earth came from. I get that. I totally fucking get that. I don't understand how we don't know. You know what this tells me, right? And this will be the wrap up on the episode too.
But this really rotates your gears in the opposite direction.
Seriously, it's 1974. How the fuck do we not know who created Skittles? I think some government agency killed the creator of Skittles because it was like,
this is some lost history bullshit right here. Yeah.
I think
let's deep dive into it.
Dude, some ingredient was changed. Maybe Skittles was the original everlasting gobstopper, but everything in the world, thanks to Gillette, was created to break fucking Gillette. Yeah.
Dude, you know what?
Right, rotates my gears in the opposite direction. Gillette.
Fix your razor.
The original Gillette guy. The original door-to-door Gillette salesman. That guy right there. That guy grinds my gears in the opposite direction.
Did you know what the shell's made out of, right? It's made out of like bug carapaces or some shit.
What, Skittles?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't care. I also don't watch how gummy bears are made because I like those and I want to continue to eat them.
We could get on a rant all day about glue and
shit. Yeah, I'm good.
People would be like, ew, gross. That's how it's made.
Yeah. The information's there if you want to go check it out.
Yeah, just watch it. That's how it's made. Yeah. And you'll never eat some of the shit ever again.
Me personally, I'm not going to. I want to continue eating it. Don't care. Out of sight, out of mind. For everyone else out there, thank you so much for listening. Thank you for liking, subscribing, chatting, chit-chatting. Don't forget to comment wherever you're listening from and tell us a little bit about your village, your town, or tell us something interesting. Maybe we'll deep dive it and go into it on the episode. We're going to figure out these cheese curds coming up soon. Very excited about that. Can't wait.
Yeah. Let's get into it.